On Friday, nurses at Waikato Hospital received a memo directing them to only speak English in clinical settings. You can see a copy of the memo here. Now, it says that concerns have been raised across the nursing workforce about the variety of spoken languages being used. It says it's timely to be reminded that English is the spoken language. And they say consistent use of one language reduces the possibility of missed care and misunderstanding. It does acknowledge other settings may include te reo Māori and or sign language, but English is the expectation in clinical settings. Well, to give their views, we're joined now by health recruiter Prudence Thompson via Zoom in Christchurch and the New Zealand Nurses Organisation's Kerry Nuku joining us from Hawke's Bay. Morena, kia kōrua. Kerry, can I start with you? What do you make of this memo?
It was really disappointing. It's an overreach, it's discriminatory in its nature, and it's unfair.
What's your understanding about how this memo has come about? Because I haven't seen anything anywhere as to why this memo was required to be sent to staff at Waikato Hospital.
That is a really difficult part to understand. So if there are incidences where English language has compromised patient safety, then absolutely there is a necessary requirement to investigate that. What we are not seeing is what has prompted this blanket, very broad memo that went out to all staff.
Yeah, which is a concern, right? Because you want to know the reason behind such a broad expectation on your staff has been sent. Is that concerning to you that that hasn't been made clear here?
Absolutely. And it's quite ironic that we say in the memo, it says that we want to use English language, one language, because we want to eliminate any miscare, misunderstanding. Clearly, this memo is creating all of that. The misunderstanding, unclear of what this is, it seems to be a targeted approach at a specific group of people. We're unsure about that. And the concerning thing for us as a people of Aotearoa is then it attacks the use of te reo Māori and takes it out of a clinical setting, but we can discuss and use te reo or sign language in any other place which isn't determining or directly impacting on patient care. And that's just wrong in a country of Aotearoa.
We're talking about clinical settings here, and that's what it says in the subject line of this memo, English in a clinical setting. Most people may not know what a clinical setting is, so I wonder whether you can explain that to us.
I think that's a difficulty that we're having as well. Clinical settings is so broad. Is that the minute you walk into the hospital, then it becomes a clinical space. The clarification of this has left meant that it's caused so significant confusion.
Prudence, can I bring you in here? And obviously from a recruiting perspective, is this a fair expectation?
Yeah, I think the memo did come as a shock. As far as an expectation, I think on induction and orientation, nurses from overseas, just getting them to understand that, you know, working with the elderly, patients who may have been confused or stressed, that English language is probably the most appropriate for clinical safety. If you're dealing with medications or procedures, I think English language would be best, but I guess it depends how the memo was delivered.
What language proficiency are international nurses expected to have in order to work in our hospitals in New Zealand?
Prior to applying for the Nurses Council, and the Nurses Council have done a really good job on this, they have to have the IELTS, which is the International English Language Test, or the OET, and it's a 6.5 and a 7, an overall band of 7, which is actually an academic score, which is quite hard. So I think the bar has been set reasonably high for English language, and all the nurses that we interview, mainly from the UK, USA, that we do make sure that they have a clear understanding that the process is to sit the English language test first. This English language test is only required for people who where English is not a first language.
Right. I would have thought that being bilingual or multilingual would be an attractive skill to have, you know, for our nurses.
Absolutely. You know, imagine being, you know, a new person, a tourist or an immigrant to the country, and having someone speak Mandarin to you, for example, or French or Japanese. You know, being bilingual has a massive advantage, especially with the population in some of our cities. I think it's fantastic. And I think it's a bonus that we bring nurses from overseas who do have these languages available to them.
Yeah, Kerry, Prudence does make, you know, some good points here. And I also do want to, we had an email come into us this morning, actually, in reference to what's happening at Waikato. She said, "I've been a patient recently in both Waikato and Auckland Hospital. Staff, no matter what race or creed, we're top notch. I see the nurses have been told to speak English to patients. It wasn't the fact a majority spoke English, but sadly many were difficult to understand, which is frustrating at times." That's fair enough. That's from a patient. Would you say that's fair enough?
I think that's a fair comment from the patient's perspective. It's important that the patient is at the centre of any safe delivery of care.
I just want to go back to this memo again, because it says consistent use of one language reduces the possibility of missed care, misunderstanding of clinical requirements, and enhances safe team work. Are you aware of any instances where using multiple languages or other languages has caused miscare, misunderstandings, or impacted patient safety?
That is the problem, that we're not aware of it. As the biggest union, professional union within the country, we're not aware of incidences. So what has triggered this response is the concern that we have.
Yes.
All nurses have to use their professional clinical judgment in any setting. We need to make sure that nurses are professionally and culturally safe to be able to deliver the care. And that is why we do support the announcement from the minister, which we hope now starts to see some clarity and give some direction. Because what he's saying is we're not stopping nurses from using their native language. However, it's up to their professional judgment around making these clinical decisions. Nurses are professional people. We need to now give them responsibility to be able to make the decision in the best choices, working with the consumers. We can't continue to make blanket statements and assume that that's okay.
Prudence, I want to bring you back in here, and I know that there are issues already around the number of international nurses that we have here in New Zealand that are looking for work, but do you think that something like this will discourage them even more from coming here?
I hope it won't discourage nurses coming from overseas. I hope it will just help educate them. And as long as we can support them and set the expectation when we interview them, and when we interview them, we are judging them and assessing their English language capabilities. So we meet them in person in their home country over Zoom, and we make sure that they've got a really good, clear English. And it's with anyone. Communication is really important, regardless of what country they come from.
Kerry, I want to come back to you and perhaps we'll wrap things up here and ask around whether the Nurses Union are aware of any other memos or directives that have been sent to nurses or staff around the country. We know that RNZ this morning is reporting a similar directive at Palmerston North Hospital. That was, to be clear, that was back in 2023, late 2023, and that was delivered via WhatsApp. Is the union aware of anything like this prior to this, or other incidents?
So we are becoming aware. This has prompted a number of responses from particularly internationally qualified nurses speaking out about this. So this has scratched the scab on the surface. I just want to say the important thing that we've got to do from this is learn as a system. In 2020, the Waitangi Tribunal identified the systemic racism within the system. And at that point, the government committed to do something. This, again, further identifies the fact that our system is not safe for some patients. It's not safe for some nurses, especially when we've got diverse populations. So we've got to do something collectively. And we're keen to be part of the redevelopment of a system that's more responsive to our diverse populations.
Kerry Nuku, New Zealand Nurses Union, and Prudence Thompson, Accent Health Recruitment Managing Director, joining us this morning. Thank you both for your time. Really appreciate it.